Yo, what is going on, people? Welcome to Throwdown, episode 391. I'm your host, Tony Polanco, and tonight I'm joined by Brett Murdoch.
What up, party people?
Brian Monjoma.
Hello, hello, hello.
And joining us once again, it's been a while, it's been a hot minute, Mr. Riku-san 1.
What up, people? What's up?
Yeah, and joining us right now, just sliding in, Carlos Romero.
Yo, 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 what's going on? What's going on?
What's going on, man? You already know. I think this may be the crew tonight. You know what I'm saying? So, Yeah. So, I'm pretty sure everybody in the chat right now can see I'm wearing a little some, but we will talk about that later. Cool. You know? Excuse me? So, how y'all doing? Riku, man, how you been, man? It's been a while. It's been a while.
I was telling Tony in the Twitter DMs because you know I recently started on a new position that has my commute up to about an hour, so I'm like, all right, I can knock out some of my podcasts now. So I was listening to some of the Throwdowns, getting caught up and whatnot. And, you know, just hearing a few things, I'm like, man, I wish I was on this episode. I could, you know, because, you know, sometimes you're like, what is that game called? We can't remember it right now. And then I'm like, no, the game is this. The game is this. Damn it. Then everybody just moves on. Or, you know, someone will say it like, you know, 5 minutes later. Oh, yeah, that's the game. Like, oh, thank God, you know. But, no, it's just a certain conversation I obviously wish I was a part of. But probably wouldn't have been able to address certain things.
And Rico, I was defending Sonic all by myself.
I was hearing it. I was like, man, oh man, you could use some backup right now.
Well, we will talk about Sonic among other things.
Talk about that.
You know? Okay, so a couple of things here. So Adam said he'll be a little late if he shows up at all. Apparently he has a migraine, so hopefully he has a speedy recovery. Manny's actually on vacation, which is good for him. You know, I don't think he's ever taken a vacation in like 20 years.
From anything.
Yeah, so he deserves that shit, you know? And we don't know what's going on with Chris. Like, Chris is becoming the new Brett, you know? It's like, he shows up. If he doesn't, he doesn't, you know?
Oh, fuck's that supposed to be? Oh, hold on.
Just like that. Yeah, just like that.
Yeah, speak of the devil, though. Speak of the devil. Mr. Chris Seeley, what's going on, man?
Yo, what's up?
Yeah, I was just saying that you're becoming the new Brett. Sometimes you show up, sometimes you don't.
Fatherhood.
I thought you guys forget when Marvel movies are released.
This is true. But you know, Chris, you get the pass. The fatherhood.
Warning.
Yeah.
Yeah, I give a warning. The Odin sleep.
The Odin sleep. I must sleep now. Recharge. You know. Good stuff, man. All right. Without getting further into it, let's get into it. Another one of these weeks. Nothing much happened, but something happened today, which I was just caught up on as I was getting back from work. I'm like, what is going on in the gaming industry right now, man? Buffoonery is what's going on. And specifically, and I'm wearing the Sony headsets right now and the Sony hat with the pony community, man. And I have to be specific about that. The pony community at the PlayStation community. PlayStation community as a whole, good community. But there are some bad apples, especially this generation. This generation, the ponies have become like last-gen Xbox. Like, any little thing you see about PlayStation negatively will set them off, man, among other things. So we got to discuss this latest craziness, right? And I got to pull it back again. I'm just learning about this myself. So if anybody in the chat can fill in some holes, please let me know, or anybody right here in the panel. But apparently, a couple of quote-unquote insiders were teasing that God of War Ragnarok's release date was going to be announced this week. I think it was either yesterday or today, one of those days, right? So motherfuckers were hype, naturally speaking, right? Like, oh, my God, it's coming. We're going to learn when this game's going to drop. So turns out that didn't happen at all. No release date. And this upset some ponies very, very much, to the point where some of them apparently started. And let me finish this, because I know this is going to sound like I'm making shit up. It got to a point where some of these guys reached out to one of the developers of the game, was a woman, and started sending her dick pics so she could tell them the release date.
Wow.
yeah, like, okay.
These guys have their finger on the pulse of what women want.
Exactly, yeah. So let me get, it's like, so again, I know there's no logic behind it, but let's try to go through the logic. So in their mind, they're like, okay, if I send her a picture of my dick, she will then be so mesmerized that she will have no choice but to let me know the release date and jeopardize her job because she's so mesmerized by my dick. I'm guessing that's what's going on through their head. You know, the bottom head, obviously. Fucking insane.
I think they're relying on a little known and ill-documented fact of dick hypnosis.
I guess. And it's like, okay, in the history of sending dick pics, has that ever worked?
I ask this question to people more regularly than you think, because it just makes for a genuine, interesting conversation. But, like, I still, for the life of me, don't understand how that works, in the sense that, like, have you ever seen, like, a woman be like, oh, man, I just need some dick pics?
Yeah.
Just, the whole thing makes no sense to me. Somewhere along the line, people are convinced, like, you know what the world needs? Pictures of my dick. Maybe it's stopping them from working.
Yeah, I don't get it. Like, I never had the urge to be like, oh, I'm going to send this girl a dick pic. Like, what? I don't, anyway, so this was...
Especially unprompted and unasked for, yeah.
Yeah. But apparently, you know, obviously this started making the rounds and stuff. Corey Barlog, who's the director of the game, he, you know, called this out. Even your boy, Uncle Phil, called this shit out, you know? And apparently there was another unrelated situation where Ron Gilbert, he's making a new Monkey Island game, I believe, right? He said that he's going to stop talking about the game on Twitter because every time he does, he gets a bunch of hate and abuse because the game's not out yet, apparently. And again, I'm trying to understand the logic here. I know there isn't. So you think that harassing a developer and putting them under stress will make them put the game out faster?
I can't actually parse whether they think, like is this, in their eyes, is this positive reinforcement or negative reinforcement? Because I have a lot of trouble believing that, like, a bunch of dudes actually got together and went, you know, I figure maybe we'll you know, entice her with dick pics, and then maybe she'll let it slip up. Like, guys can't be that dense, right? Like,
no, they guys have to know that
they're
dense.
Just harassing her, like,
Jesus,
harassing her until she gives it up, maybe?
Yeah, but again, it's like, so she is going to ruin her... No, she wants to get herself fired for you, some random person who sent her a dick pic. She's going to ruin her entire career
for a dick pic. I mean, maybe she's doing it, like, to stop getting the dick pic. Like, maybe that's their angle. Like, we'll keep sending the dick pics until we get a release date.
I don't know, man, but these guys are out of their minds. And again, all this happened because they thought the release date was going to be announced. There was no official word. Sony never said this. It was just a bunch of insiders speculating, you know?
But in fairness, I'm a subscriber to the 80-20 rule, right? Things are rarely 100% one party or another. It's rarely black and white. It's rarely binary. So, you know, I do have to say the 20% here is if Sony weren't so goddamn mum on a lot of this shit, you know, we might not be seeing a lot of this behavior emerge. I'm not saying it's the correct response. I'm just saying I kind of understand the base frustration that they're getting a little bit. That's where our paths diverge. But, like, I feel like announcing a game 6 years before it's, you know, ever released, like, I feel like this is the end consequence, right? Like, you want to get people into this consumerist frenzy. But the problem with that is, when you do that, if you don't do it just right or you do it too long at all, people start to get fucking agitated. And you're trying to keep them on this sweet spot of, like, frenzy for the game. So, you know, so much so that they're going to pre-order, but not so much that they're frustrated. And that's a losing act most of the time. I feel like this is a monster that they created by insisting on announcing games 8 years before they release.
Yeah, I like how you went from 6 years to 8 years.
I know, but dude, I swear to God, every time they announce a game 10 years before it comes out, it ruins my day.
Yeah. What about the rest of you guys? Like, Rico, what's your thoughts on all this nonsense, man? I know you must have seen it on the Twitters.
Oh, yeah. There's so many angles this can come from in regards to how fucked up this is. One interesting angle I heard from the, you know, console wars, from the Sony Pony side that tried to defend
this.
And this may also sound ridiculous, but it's so ridiculous that it can't, I feel like it can't be disregarded as a possibility because of how ridiculous all of the fans within the gaming community are. And what they said was they felt that this was the person who did this to the developer was an undercover Xbox fan.
Oh, here we go. Always, I knew they were gonna say that. They always say that shit.
They were saying that this has to be an undercover Xbox fan trying to make us PlayStation fans look as crazy as them.
But the thing is, at least according to the developer, it wasn't just one guy. It was multiple guys doing this. You know
they'll say it. They'll say it.
Oh, yeah, you know, they're going to be like, oh, no, it's an undercover Xbox. It's got to be, an undercover Xbox.
False flag, flag.
And then the meta gets even deeper when it's like, okay, where if they're going to be that petty, well, when the next Xbox game come out, I'm going to send a whole bunch of dick pics to your developers. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, what is this fucking turning into? A fucking undercover secret agent dick pic sending bullshit. Like, it's ridiculous. All of it. Just like, fucking leave them alone. They shouldn't have to fucking close their DMs, but it seems like that's what needs to happen. Since these motherfuckers don't know how to act right on either side. You know?
Yeah. I gotta read this real quick. Logic once. What's going on, brother? He goes, was it also an undercover Xbox fan who cried to Biden to stop the Activision Blizzard deal? Remember that shit? Like, oh, please. They were adding Joe Biden. Add Mr. President, stop this deal.
It's ridiculous.
Ponies, like, man.
Regardless if it was a pony or an undercover Xbox or vice versa, like, both of the fan bases are fucking ridiculous. Like, it's fucking brain rot.
Yeah.
It's peak brain rot. It's like, Jesus Christ.
Like, okay. You know, if you guys heard the show, you know I have a tier of fanboys, right? You know, how they rank, you know, from most toxic to least, even though they're all fucking toxic, right? So, my original tier was Nintendo guys at the top, right? Absolutely vile, right? After that, you had the Xbox guys, then you had the PC guys, then you had the ponies, right? Now, ponies before were more or less just innocent trolls, right? But now, I've never heard of Nintendo guys or Xboxes or PC guys sending dick pics. So, congratulations, fanboys. You've made it to number one now. You know? I think the PlayStation guys, and obviously couple it with everything else that's been going on. It's because of these, I'm keeping it real right now. It's because of these fucking idiots that your boy, me, ended up being blasted all over the internet by the gaming websites because I dared to unsubscribe from Game Pass, even though you figured I would make them happy, you know? Ponies this fucking generation are the worst. And again, I'm being very specific with that tone, with that verbiage. Ponies, not PlayStation fans. PlayStation fans, cool people. Ponies are fucking toxic as hell, you know?
I mean, you almost got, in the hierarchy, you almost have PlayStation fans, fanboys, and then ponies are at the top of that, right?
Here's the thing. I don't think PlayStation fans are bad because they're just regular people.
That's what I'm saying. You have PlayStation fans, just regular people. Yeah,
regular
people.
You
have fanboys, people enthusiastic about the brand, and then you have fanboys, people toxic about the brand.
Yeah. That's pretty fair. Because you're right. You can be a fanboy without being toxic. That is possible. It used to be that way. But
yeah, you know, a cheerleader. That's okay. It's okay to be happy and excited about things.
All good. Yeah. It's when you start harassing developers, the people who are giving you these games, that's when things go crazy, you know?
Let me throw something out here also to take into consideration. I would say around, I don't want to say the PS2 era, because it's like in the PS2 era, it doesn't. I want to say that the first time you obviously heard about like friendly competition in regards to consoles going back and forth between each other was obviously, you know, Sega and
Nintendo, yeah, right? Back in the day.
It was very light, wholesome competition. Nothing toxic whatsoever. And, you know, it wasn't until, you know, I would say when Crash came in and started doing all of that crazy shit, but at the same time, it was still at a company level where they're just throwing little fun shots at each other, still nothing toxic, right? PS2, I felt like, even though it wasn't directly fanboy wars between Xbox and PS2 guys, I do feel that around that era is when inklings of toxicity started to show itself, and not necessarily between the platform holders, you know, PlayStation guys and Xbox guys. It felt like during that time it was more so people were on the side of a specific game and bashing another franchise's fans within, you know, that same platform. The only reason I'm mentioning this right now is because obviously during the time the PS2 had majority of the fans, you know, majority of the market share, the masses were there, right? But when we went over to the next generation, as we all know, majority of the people who had PS2s, when they moved over to the next generation, they didn't get PlayStation 3s. They got Xbox 360s, yeah. Right? So the beginning of that like toxicity started in the masses of the PS2, but then it moved over to the 360, and we know how the early ages of Xbox Live was. That's when the toxicity really started to become like a thing, right? People calling motherfuckers the N-word on the first day in Xbox Live chat rooms. That's when it really started. And obviously when the PS3 came out, it was overpriced, and then, you know, the small amount of people who got their hands on it, the people who were on the Xbox, I don't want to call them Xbox 360 fans, the masses who were on the Xbox 360 fan base at the time, who were originally PS2 toxic people, were shitting on, you know, the people who own PS3s, right? And then that's when that console war started, right? But then you move over to the next generation where that masses that were on the Xbox 360 moved over to the PS4, right? So now the masses are on the PS4, and, you know, Xbox One came out, didn't really have a lot going for it. They were making a lot of mistakes. The console war continues. And now we're moving over to the next generation where it seems like, you know, in regards, if you're looking at, you know, the PS5 and the Xbox Series X, majority of them are over on the PlayStation side. And I feel that's why you are starting to see that same. I feel like that toxic fan base has been jumping from platform to platform. And that's why when you like look at that specific generation and see which one was the most toxic during that time, it lines up, right? So I don't want to call them PlayStation ponies or Xbox. There is a specific group of toxic people that are migrating per generation and making that specific platform during that time look far more toxic than it actually is.
That's a pretty interesting take.
I just want to make sure I'm understanding this correctly, because I think I agree with him. I think I've had some of the same idea, but are you saying that the place where the mainstream greater chunk of the public goes tends to end up as a more toxic place?
Yeah, in a nutshell, correct.
Okay, yeah, that would make sense.
Yeah, I'm going to have to agree with that. And I'm going to take it back right now.
It makes the statistical sense as well.
Yeah, no, it does. Like, yeah, where the majority goes. And here's something, Enrico, you kind of alluded to this, but I'm going to just flat out bluntly say it, mm-hmm. Right? I'm going to get hate. I don't care. I think gaming toxicity really started with the Xbox.
Of course you do.
The first Xbox. That
here's the thing.
Let me break this down, right? That is where you saw the beginning of the bro gamer, you know, those kind of guys, the meathead gamers, right? You saw that, right? And I'm tying this with what you said. Those type of dudes then started console hopping to different systems and stuff. And obviously not the same guys, the same type of people. But if you really think about it, all that shit, the toxic chat rooms and shit, all that started on Xbox. Not 360, Xbox, the original. Let me finish. This is something I've actually been thinking about for a number of years. I saw somebody say it on Twitter. I never thought about that, but that's true. All this shit really started on the original Xbox, and we're continuing to see it further. Brett, jump in and disagree with me.
Evidence.
Here's
evidence. We didn't have chat rooms before that. That's why.
No.
You know.
I understand that, but like. Like, did you own an original Xbox?
I did not, but I had plenty of friends, and I was on those chat rooms, and I heard some crazy shit. Now, I thought it was funny when I was, like, fucking 20, but Xbox, Chris, getting here, too, because you owned that original Xbox. You could vouch for this shit. Carlos, you could vouch for this, too. Those original chat rooms set the precedent for everything that would follow, you know?
Yeah, it kind of was like a meme back in the day. It's like... They said some vile shit.
Let me say something.
All that shit. Think about it. Think about all the horrible shit you've ever heard about. Oh, gamer chat rooms. Where did that come from? It ain't come from the Dreamcast chat rooms. I'll tell you that. It came from the Xbox. It came from
Aaron's chat, yo. You know? You want to? Here's the thing. I'm talking a different level. I had like that kind of shit was nothing compared to the shit that you saw in things like WoW, and definitely not the kind of shit that you saw. Any worse in any form or anything like that. Like it wasn't disproportionate to that corner of the internet. It was just a subsection of the internet.
Let me say something in regards to that.
No, you go and then I'll go.
So two things. I agree and disagree with Tony, and I agree and disagree with Brett. It's gonna be a little tricky. I'll start with Brett. Brett, I agree. A lot of those games had toxic moments, but the reason why, and this is really specific, the reason why you didn't see it as much as sort of what we're stating, because you weren't Mexican or black in Xbox Live, I got called the N-word like hundreds of times.
Same here.
No, and that's entirely possible. I'm not going to deny that. I'm not fighting that at all.
But I do agree that, I mean, there's toxicity's been prevalent for ages now. So yeah, here's where I'm going to agree and disagree with Tony. I agree that probably the modern toxicity, the modern age of toxicity probably did start with the Xbox.
Yeah.
But that's because the Xbox was the first console that came out during the quote-unquote internet age.
Yeah, and I'm glad really you say that.
The internet age that started everything.
Yeah, obviously, if we go back, it's just the internet in general fucked gaming up entirely. But, and I'm glad you said that because, like, obviously you had platforms like WoW, whatever, that had toxicity too. But that shit was not nearly as popular as a fucking home console that was for normies. Like Riku said, you know, that those guys are the ones that really started this shit. So
back then it was a fucking nerd.
I'm pretty sure WoW had more of an active monthly subscriber base than most AAA blockbuster games.
We're talking about in general.
There were more people playing WoW than the single most popular game on
Xbox. Look what you're doing. You're taking, okay, all of WoW just compared to one game. No, we're taking WoW compared to everybody that was playing on Xbox.
Yeah, no, I said compared to the most popular, but here's my point, because I feel like I'm getting a little off track. The point that I wanted to make is, I'm not saying there was a toxicity, and I'm not saying there was a toxicity everywhere, but for those of us that were there in the beginning, I think Adam would back us up, being the first people to online game, like legitimately and genuinely online game repeatedly and with each other a lot, it tended to foster a lot of community. And that community tends to help repel the things like racism and homophobia and random just trolling that you find from just random people. when I experienced a massive my trolling was when I went over to the PlayStation, because it seemed like nobody knew proper etiquette on how to deal in a group or in voice chat, right? I can't tell you, even down to, like, how many people coughing over bongs or crying babies have you fucking heard in PlayStation? People are just inconsiderate of each other's in general, and that kind of subculture exists to this day. PlayStation is not seen as a, you know, the kind of place where you game along with people.
I would change PlayStation to just home console online gaming.
Yeah, because what you're describing is literally every home console. Yeah,
Brett, I feel like we're not trying to make this as an Xbox issue. I feel like you're trying to defend it as an Xbox issue.
No. I'm not. I'm saying that there's positive and negative that comes with having more social online interaction.
Well, and that's such a fact. Yeah,
painting this toxic game base originated here. I just don't think that that's super accurate. I'm not saying there wasn't toxic elements to it, but I don't think it's where the idea of learning to be a toxic shithead on the internet kind of came from.
Xbox Live was a fucking shit show. Every game, every multiplayer game I played, Halo 2, you know, even when I played, you know, Call of Duty, when I got on Splinter Cell co-op, like, it was everywhere. That's what it was known. People used to be, when YouTube started popping up, people used to post chat room videos. Yeah, Xbox Live of just people losing their shit.
Yeah, I mean, there'd be times when we'd start sessions in like Gears of War where we just start booting people. They just start fucking swearing and like insulting people, and it's like, all right, keep running your mouth, and then you just pick people to just fucking kick from the game before you start. And that was every game session.
Every game session. It was ridiculous.
Like, yeah, that's your evidence, by the way.
Go ahead.
Yeah, let me say the thing I was trying to say after Carlos. So in regards to, you know, Tony's statement in regards to it possibly originally starting from the original Xbox, what I have to say about that is the first time I've ever even heard the words Halo was that, like, I think I was like in sixth grade, and someone was talking about how amazing Halo Online was and whatnot. And this is the first time I even heard about Halo, so I thought they were talking about some game about angels or some shit.
Okay.
So I was like, when they were talking about it, they're like, yeah, it's on the Xbox, right? And that was my first time hearing about an Xbox. And the first time I heard someone talk about the Xbox was them instantly going directly attacking the PlayStation 2 in regards to how superior the Xbox is from a spec standpoint. The fact that it had a hard drive, the fact that its games look better, and that it runs better, and that the PlayStation 2 is shit. And the fact that they can say this because they also had a PlayStation 2 and could compare it, and no one could tell them otherwise. So I don't know if you guys have heard the phrase that has been becoming a bit more popular now recently than ever before, called the fake neutral.
Oh, yeah. No, I've been called that. By the way, I don't... This could derail the whole conversation, what I'm about to say right now. Uh-huh. I don't think fake neutrals are real. I think they're a straw man created by the fanboys, you know, to have something to lash at. I don't think those are fucking real. I refuse to believe that someone buys a console they hate just to shit on it. That's stupid. So I don't believe in fake neutrals.
You may not believe in it. I actually personally believe in it, only because of the fact that you kind of see it. We kind of saw evidence of it when the announcement of Final Fantasy VII Remake Part 2 only coming to PS5. People online, like Kidsmove, talking about the fact that, oh yeah, I own a PlayStation 5, but I never play it. There's no reason to play it. And then when they announced Final Fantasy VII Remake Part 2 only coming to PS5, even though he has a PS5, he's like, why the fuck is it not coming to Xbox? This is bullshit. And he's like, okay, you have a PS5 right in your living room. Why are you mad that it's not coming to Xbox when you have a PS5 right there? As a multi-platform gamer, you shouldn't be angry because you own the platform that they said it's coming to.
Let's be real though.
Yeah, Kids Move is not
he's not a Fredo. That guy's an Xbox guy. That guy literally calls himself the Best Bot. Like,
come on now. He also calls himself a neutral gamer.
No, and he's not a fucking neutral gamer.
No, he's
and that's what I'm saying. And that's what I'm saying. If he's going out of his way to call himself that, even though we know he's not, that by definition makes him a fake neutral.
Yeah, but no, but he's an edge case because he's an influencer. He's like the Fox News or MSNBC of fucking fanboy wars. Yeah.
By the way, just real quick, because you know, this may get out. Kiss Move, I love you. I have no problem with you, dude. We, you know, we've met in real life. You're a cool dude, but just being honest, what you are, just saying, man. But no hate. Just being honest. That's my dude, man. Yeah.
It's not just him. I just saw it on when that week happened. I saw a lot of Xbox guys who said that they have PlayStations. They don't play it, but they were mad at the fact that, it wasn't just him.
Hold on, Rico. I got to stop you. By that logic, I was the fake neutral because I had an Xbox One last generation. I never played it either. And I shitted on it.
My Switch.
You know what I'm saying? Come on, bro. That shit doesn't exist. There's no such thing as a fake neutral. You know?
I consider it a fake neutral if you call yourself a neutral gamer, but you don't.
Who the fuck calls himself a neutral gamer? Like that specific phrase.
People call him a
neutral gamer. No, people actually say that.
Yeah, people actually do. People actually.
I don't know about that. But Brian, what's up, man?
No, I was about to say, like, I just find it funny how Rico had mentioned that there was like a bunch of Xboxes or Xbox that mentioned that they had PlayStation 5s, you know, and they probably don't. And I'm just like, that's kind of that time when like all these PlayStation guys say that they have like high end PCs to play Xbox games.
That's right. Actually, yeah,
I'm sure that most of them don't.
Yeah,
no, I agree. That's the same thing. But the only reason I mentioned that was back to that first guy who had the Xbox. It's the fact that he also had a PS2. And that brings me back to my original point that regardless if it was an Xbox guy who may have started that toxicity, he openly admitted that he also had a PS2. Still proving my point that the PS2 still had the biggest share of players within its like user base, because he's a part of it too. He may be a part of the Xbox side, but he's also a part of the PS2 side since he has both of them. It doesn't change the fact that once again, majority of where the players are is where the toxicity usually.
That makes sense, just numbers wise. You know what I'm saying? That does make sense. Go ahead, Carlos.
Yeah, I mean, like Rigo said, statistically, it's probably more likely that PlayStation 2 had a lot more toxic people. That's fair to say.
Yeah, I agree.
But I will say PS2 is a kind of weird case because the PS2 was, I feel like it was more prevalent as a fucking DVD player for the wider audience, for the mass audience. And, you know, I feel like everyone had a PS2 for a DVD player.
Like I said, in regards to the toxicity within the PS2 community that I personally remember, it wasn't attacking Xbox guys because there were barely any during that time, firstly. It felt like they were more attacking each other in regards to their favorite franchises. I remember a time where people were, Devil May Cry fans were attacking God of War fans. And Final Fantasy fans were attacking Dragon Quest fans. And, you know, Ratchet fans were attacking Jack and Daxter fans. I remember that one. Jack versus Ratchet fans. That's what I remember, right? It wasn't until the next generation where now they're just attacking each other's platforms. But before that, they were attacking each other's franchises. Which is still kind of happening today, but it's nowhere near as crazy as platform versus platform.
I used to attack the fuck out of the PlayStation 2 like as a platform.
You still do.
No, I mean, here's the deal. At the time, I was working at a video game store, so like I was real brushed up on my shit. I was like, I mean, one's stronger, and people would get all up on my case and be like, "Well, no." So I'm like, look, I'm not saying how the power is used. I'm not saying whether it's even well utilized. I'm just saying one is spec'd stronger. This is before a lot of people got to like spec. This is before we had a lot of internet videos and shit like that that really, you know, broke it down. So I remember getting into constant fights with people about that. But that wasn't even like, I guess, attacking a system as being like, well, I mean, it's not the more powerful of the two, but it's got a lot more games.
Yeah. All right. Anything else you guys want to say about this whole God of War situation or toxicity in gaming in general?
Ridiculous. Whatever platform has the masses, that's where the toxicity is at. So
yeah, PlayStation, you're the winner. 16.
Yeah. How about harassed developers?
Yeah, stop harassing developers. Yeah, like you actually want these people to police against
everyone else.
Yeah, how about that too? You know,
start harassing the heads, man. Start harassing the heads of the development. Start
don't harass anyone. We don't condone that around here.
If they have a Q&A, if they have an open forum, you ask them like, "Oh, how come we don't have a release date?" That's reasonable. No, it's not reasonable. Taking a shot of your dick and mailing it to a developer. That's not reasonable.
Exactly. Okay. Absolutely insane. All right, man. We're going to switch gears hardcore right now. Let's talk about Nintendo. Nintendo. So Nintendo had we have to. Don't worry. This is just, you know, my chance to dunk on Nintendo, which is always good.
Toxicity.
Listen, man, I am not a fake neutral. You know, I will admit I do not like Nintendo. You know,
I've got a Nintendo Switch and it's gathering dust, so I guess I am.
Oh, yeah, you are a fake neutral. I have a Nintendo Switch as well. It's not collecting dust because it's always inside of its case, which I never open. The case is collecting dust, though, you know?
Yeah.
All right, so we had a Nintendo Direct this week. It was called the Nintendo Direct Mini. So I'm guessing it was like 26 minutes, it says here. So I'm reading this off of Destructoid, so if I miss anything, let me know, right? So they announced that Nier, Persona, and Mega Man are coming to Nintendo. Is that what's happening now?
Correct.
Yep.
Okay. Here we go. Nier Automata, the End of Yorha Edition, is finally coming to Switch October 6th. It will include all the DLC. Does anybody have any strong feelings on that?
Yes. So I find it funny that in regards to Nier in particular, that this what kind of like similar to Dragon Quest XI. S, you know, originally before when it was only on the Switch, this will be a version of the game that from a performance standpoint will be the worst version of the game to exist. But from a content standpoint, this is the best version to play. So just like Dragon Quest XI S before it came back to the PlayStation, it's funny how Square ends up doing that.
Yeah, that is kind of interesting, isn't it? All right, so we got that. Next up, we have Harvestella. What the fuck is that? I don't know what that is.
It looks, I think that's another game that's by Square, and it looks like it's supposed to be a combination of, you know, those farming games like...
It says it right here. It's
like Harvest Moon?
Yeah, it's life simulation RPG with farming and crafting.
Yeah, when you look at the gameplay, it's like a hybrid between what you just said and an action combat JRPG, which is weird.
What?
Like, let me look at this fucking going, trailer. If you watch the gameplay, the character is going out there and actually fighting things, but then you see other instances where the character is like, you know, actually farming and making crops and whatnot. It's a weird combination. Not sure who asked for it, but you know how certain new things go. Nobody asked for it. Everybody now loves it. I didn't know I actually wanted this in my life type of shit.
Oh. All right, so I'm watching this.
Combat in it.
You said what? Okay. But on like a JRPG, an action JRPG level type of combat, or just like some, you know?
It's kind of like a Legend of Zelda, old school, like...
Yeah, when you look at the game...
Correct, you go down into like a cave, and each level of the cave you go down, enemies get harder, and...
Yeah, look at that. There's actually hack and slash in here too.
Yeah, it like legit looks like an action JRPG, which is interesting.
But there's farming shit.
Yeah. Like I said,
I really like that.
It's like what you do with Persona, where it's like Persona is a legit turn based JRPG, but then the other half of there's Persona
some
is
shit, yeah.
Yeah. So I think they're trying to like do something a dynamic that is similar to that, where it's just two different genres that are drastically different in one game, and you go back and forth between the two.
Hmm. All right. Yeah, I'm watching the trailer. Not for me, but it's interesting, I guess. Next up, we have Persona 3 Portable, Persona 4 Golden, and Persona 5 Royal are coming to Switch. Motherfuckers finally got their wish. Remember, mm-hmm. they've been asking this for years. I think since the Switch launched, right? It's like, yo, where's Persona? You know? Mm-hmm. So there you go. But it's like, here's the thing. I'm noticing a trend already with some of this shit. It's like, too little, too late. You know what I'm saying? It's like, we've had these on other systems. You know, and just keeping it really real. Play it on Steam Deck, man. Just saying,
I agree with you in regards to all of that, which is funny because it's like, here's the thing, Tony. I won't call you Tony. That's funny.
Tony.
In regards to the Nintendo fans that I follow and see, I don't know if you guys know a Nintendo guy named Blandrew.
I know Blandrew. Shout out to him, man.
Yeah, crazy Nintendo guy, right?
Oh, he's absolutely fucking crazy, but I still like the guy, you know?
Oh, yeah, he's a friend of mine. He openly admitted on Twitter today that he had bought Persona 5 in particular. I don't know Royal or Vanilla, but in total, he's bought Persona 4 to 5 times before this Switch version, and he said he has never completed Persona 5, even though he's bought it 4 to 5 times. And he's always been telling people that once it comes to Switch, then I will buy it again and actually beat it this time. And everyone that was on Twitter was talking about why are you waiting for it to come to Switch when you bought it 5 times on different platforms and you could have beaten it already. And he was talking about the fact that he prefers to play his long JRPGs in the palm of his hand, on the go, all of that stuff. And you know, some people agree with him, some people didn't. But like Nier that we just talked about, this is the same case to which and where, firstly, when Xbox a couple weeks ago had their showcase and they announced the fact that, you know, Persona is coming to Xbox. And then like 20 to 48 hours later, they, you know, announced that those three games are also coming to PS5 as well. I assume during that time, Nintendo was like, we're not going to announce it. We're going to wait till we have our little direct and then we're going to give the Nintendo fans that they want. But when they announced it for PS5 and Xbox Series X, they talked about the fact that Persona 5 Royal will be running at 60 frames per second, which the PS4 version ran at 30. And so it's like, that's cool that it's going to be running at 60. Obviously, you don't need it for a turn-based JRPG, but seeing 60 frames on any fucking genre, it's better looking on. It's easier on the eyes than 30 frames, regardless. But the Switch version is still going to be running. Is not going to be running at 60. So once again, just like Nier, you're going to be playing an inferior version performance-wise. But you got it on the go, right? Yeah, you might, like Tony said, if you want on the go and you want 60 frames, you might as well just go and get it on the Steam Deck.
Yeah. Interesting. All right, moving on. What's the next thing here? Okay, I don't know how to pronounce the name of this game, so I'm going to say all versions, and maybe one of them will be the thing. Live alive. Take the pick.
I got the correct way. The second one you said is the correct. So it's
live alive.
No, it's alive alive.
Alive alive. Live alive. All right. Mm-hmm. Anyway, there's a demo for it. What the fuck is this game?
So in regards to Live Alive, just to give you a little backstory on that one, that was a cult classic Super Nintendo game that came out. It was like a game that came out a few years before Chrono Trigger, and it's supposed to be a turn-based JRPG on paper that each of its like JRPG characters have their own branching stories that all take place in different time periods. So one of them is like in the distant future and it's all sci-fi, like Mass Effect like. One character is from Edo, Japan, and he's a ninja. One is from the Stone Age. One is from the Wild West. And you go through all of their stories and, you know, some crazy time thing happens that brings them all together and all that other stuff. And apparently it's supposed to be a really, really, really good hidden gem Super Nintendo JRPG that never got localized over here. And we got a few fans translations, and that's how some people were able to play, but it never came over. So now that they're bringing it over and putting the whole HD 2D remake on it, you know, to make it look like Octopath, and everyone started flipping out. And even though it's a Super Nintendo game, you know, Square and Nintendo are like, we're going to put that tax on it. So it's going to cost $50 when it comes out on
the Never Switch. Change Nintendo, never change. I'm looking at the trailer now. It actually looks pretty cool.
Yeah. A lot of people are saying they're having a lot of fun with the demo. It's living up to its hype, and you know, so some people are like they don't like it. So it's like it's something that you're going to have to get in there and try it for yourself. But on paper it sounds really unique, especially for something that predates Chrono Trigger but had, you know, a time related aspect as that as well.
Interesting. Yeah, looks cool. All right, put it on a console. I'll actually play it on though, please. All right, Capcom. I'm reading off of the Destructoid. Capcom, who seems contractually obligated to appear in every Nintendo stream, reiterated its roadmap for Monster Hunter Rise Sunbreak. So that's the expansion, right?
Yeah.
Oh, hold on. Nicole, a bunch of numbers is not following. Shout out. I hope you're not a troll. With all those numbers, when you see like 50 numbers, you're like, oh shit, here we go. Okay, so we have Portal Companion Collection. So Portal 1 and 2 are coming to the Switch. So, yeah. Again, like 50 years later, you're getting these fucking games. You know? Next, Nintendo showed off more Minecraft Legends. I don't care. Riku, let's talk about it now, man.
Yeah.
Sonic Frontiers. So apparently they showed some more. I was going to save this to the end of the show, but no, let's do it now. We're doing it live. Sonic Frontiers. Tell us about this game, because yesterday, because I have been playing, and I submitted my review for Sonic Origins, which I think is great, aside from the whole Sonic 3 soundtrack fiasco. I think it's great, and I'm like, listen, play this over instead of that Sonic Frontiers nonsense, you know? On the other day on Twitter, I'm like, because I was curious. I was like, is there anyone who's actually legitimately excited for this game, right?
And what do we say in the show?
Every single time. You know Riku is. It's funny, because I always do this, and Riku doesn't have glasses, but I'm like, you know? Riku, why are you excited for this game? If you're excited.
Yeah. So I would say, I wouldn't necessarily use the word excited, but I would like to use the word looking forward to it. So it's like, you know, I guess I would be a few tiers below excited, you know, so not hype or excited, but yeah, I am looking forward to it only because of the fact that, one, I've always been someone who's, you know, I'm someone who grew up with 3D Sonic, you know, my first, like, I feel like the first Sonic game I really got into was Sonic Adventure 1. You know, it was my cousin who had the Sega Genesis and the 2D Sonics and whatnot. I was the one that had the SNES with Super Mario and whatnot. So for me, I've always been a 2D Mario fan. I never really cared for the 3D Mario. And then for Sonic, it was backwards. I've always been a 3D Sonic fan. But it's not that I didn't like the 2D Sonics. I never got my hands on them, or, you know, I was always playing the 3D ones. So with that being said, Sonic Adventure is my shit. You know, I liked running around in the adventure field, playing the action stages, all that shit. So, you know, with the failure that was Sonic 2006, you know, I kind of fell off of Sonic around that time. We just went to go and play other stuff. So that big period between 2006 and now, I haven't played any of those Sonic games. So for me, prior to 2006, those 3D Sonic games that came out prior to 2006, so like Sonic Heroes and whatnot, I still kind of had a positive look on 3D Sonic during that time. You know, I left when it really got bad. So I personally never like tainted my perspective on 3D Sonic, even though I knew it got bad, and I was like, I'm not coming back until I legit see something that interests me to come back. And since then, I haven't seen anything, you know, until now. So when I saw Frontiers and what it was doing, it did look like this would be a spiritual successor to at least Sonic Adventure 1 in particular. Not 2, because, you know, 2 didn't have an adventure stage. You just had all of your stages on that big map, and you just went to the action stages. This one, you actually have that adventure stage. You're going around doing stuff, and then they also said you have the action stages within the adventure stage. So I'm like, okay, that to me, that sounds like a spiritual successor to Sonic Adventure, at least from a gameplay standpoint. So I'm sold. In regards to the gameplay videos that they've shown prior to the one they showed on the Nintendo Direct, some of them were iffy, especially the first one, because I don't know what Sega was thinking when they gave that footage to IGN, having Sonic literally just walk here, move very slow there. Like, that was a very bad first impressions you could have given literally every variation of a Sonic fan. That was not a good showing. The second showing was a little bit better, because the guy who was playing looked like he was actually kind of trying to be Sonic, not just here's how the grass looks, here's how this is, like, you know. And then the one they showed on the Direct, that one was probably the best trailer so far, showing us far more than any of the prior stuff. So I'm looking forward to it in regards to that. On top of the fact that from a story standpoint, they said that the person who is in charge of all of the certain plot. So Sega had a story, right? And they gave that story plot to a specific writer who executes the story beats that's going to happen in Sonic Frontiers. And the writer who's doing that is a writer, the same writer who is writing the Sonic IDW comics. And I've been reading those. That, from a story standpoint, is probably the best written Sonic content ever. Everything about it is extremely impressive and has no right being that good for Sonic. So they brought him in to make sure that the story, at least for Sonic Frontiers, is going to be respectable. So at least, even from a story standpoint, I'm looking forward to it, knowing that he is making sure that everything... This guy knows his fucking Sonic. Like, he has a whole podcast where he just talks about Sonic and the lore and just answering everybody's questions for 2 hours bi-daily for the past, like, 2 years. It's ridiculous.
That's insane.
It's called the Bumblecast. I've been listening to it. And I'm like, this dude goes fucking deep into this fucking Sonic lore. It's ridiculous. And this guy is that I basically dedicated my whole... He said he feels like he's dedicated his whole life to just fucking Sonic lore. And I was just like, yeah, if you're going to have someone who's going to, like, treat the story correctly, you might want to have this guy. And Sega got that guy. So I'm like, all right, well, we'll see how it turns out. But, like, I don't know. Everything on paper sounds like it's going to be better than what, you know, a lot of the 3D Sonic teams that we've had before. So
we'll see. Right. Yeah. I, you know, Riku, you already know my stance on these things, so
yeah.
I don't give a fuck. I even said this in my Sonic Origins thing. I'm like, I don't need Sonic to have a story. Just have him fight Robotnik, and I'm good. I don't need story. You know. And by the way, I'm surprised there's still Sonic comics around. I'm like, that's still a thing. I mean, listen, yeah. If you people like it, that's great. And I'm glad that, you know, Sonic fans are getting a respectable comic series. That's fantastic, but. For me, like, after Sonic Adventure, I was like, nah, this franchise doesn't work in 3D. Like, every game I've played, like, and it's funny because I like Sonic Adventure when it first came out, but literally 2 years after the fact, when I went back, I'm like, oh, this is not good. What the fuck was I thinking? You know? I think I was just blown away by the graphics or whatever, right? Because you've never seen shit like that before.
Crazy thing about that is I'm currently playing through Resident Evil 1 for the first time.
That's rough.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you how rough that is, right? Because I tried to play the remake, right, that we put on PS4. I couldn't do it. Mm-hmm.
So, you know? So for me, it's like everyone, you know, 91 on Metacritic. Everybody loves Resident Evil 1 remake. Someone on Twitter said, the best remake ever. And I'm just like, all right, I'm in here and I'm playing it. And I'm just like...
Remember, just because a game gets highly rated doesn't mean it's good. Let's just be real here. You know,
here's the. I think they're the rate. The people who are rating it are more so looking at it as a faith. How faithful of a remake is this to the original PS1 version? And as a remake, as a faithful remake to that PS1 version, I can see where they're coming from. But as a game, and how well did it age? Regardless of it being a remake, it did not age well. There's a lot of mechanics that just did not age well, right?
Yeah.
And I'm playing through it. I'm because I promised a friend I'm gonna play through all the Resident Evils. I'm gonna get caught up in all that shit. But I'm gonna start from one. And I was telling him, I was like, yeah, if you're someone who likes Resident Evil 1, this game's probably, you know, good for you. But for someone like me and anyone who, you know, probably experienced other survival horror or third-person similar third-person shooters, so like Last of Us or Dead Space or anything like that, or even the later Resident Evils, this game isn't going to mesh well with them, right? And I was telling him that, in my opinion, I think Resident Evil 1 deserves another remake.
I agree, yeah, like in the style of 2 and 3, yeah.
Yeah, and I was telling him, I was like, The one that you have right now, that's good for the people who like that original style. And that version of it is polished to the T. And I don't think anything is wrong with that version and what it was trying to be. But for the people who want to experience maybe Resident Evil 1, but playing like how the Resident Evil 2 remake plays, I think that a version of like of that should exist too. And I was telling him, it was like, and when he was starting to think, I was like, yeah, I would love to play Resident. You know, these Resident Evil fans would love to play Resident Evil 1 again in a different way. So let's not pretend like they wouldn't fucking accept it, you know, if it existed, right? So I was just like, I think that should exist. And I feel the same way about Sonic Adventure 1 and 2, where it's like you said, you feel from a gameplay standpoint they haven't aged well. I, you know, would debate you on that, but here's the thing. I don't disagree that the games have an age and that they definitely do deserve a remake, right? So it's like, yeah, they a lot of fucking games from that era are getting remakes. Crash, Spyro, you know.
Yeah, but the thing is, a remake wouldn't, and this is just, you know, my opinion, a remake wouldn't save those Sonic games. I think Sonic fundamentally does not work as 3D games. I think it only works in 2D, right? It's not like Mario seamlessly transitioned into 3D. It works both ways. Sonic has proven that it does not work. Fundamentally does not work. That, again, I know we disagree on that. I'm not going to change your mind on that, but I understand that.
And I'm not trying to change your mind on that either. But I want you to take this into consideration. Maybe it doesn't work fundamentally because of the fact that the developers behind it don't know what the fuck they're doing. Now,
it's,
I want you to
it's
take
this clear into, here, they don't know what they're here, doing. You know,
here's the thing. I want you to also take this into consideration. I've always said that if I had to choose a developer to make a 3D Sonic game, and who I think would nail it would be Insomniac. I definitely think that if let's say in some random fucking dimension that fucking Sega got bought out by PlayStation, and PlayStation owns all of Sega shit, right? And Insomniac was in charge of working on like Sonic from moving forward.
We're getting into hypotheticals now, Riku.
Yeah, no, I know it's hypotheticals, but the thing is, you've played Ratchet and Clank, you've played Rift Apart. You know from a gameplay standpoint that game is sound as fuck. It's refined to the T. Ratchet and Clank, since the beginning, has always been smooth on its gameplay. But when you look at Ratchet and Clank, other than Ratchet moving super fast, his mechanics aren't that different than what 3D Sonic is doing. In regards to, he grinds on rails just like, you know, 3D Sonic and Sonic Adventure 2. He's grinding on rails, he's hopping from rail to rail. He has hover boots like Shadow the Hedgehog. It's like, I don't see Insomniac not making a good Sonic game if it was in their hands. Sonic Team, like you said, Sonic Team has proven that they can't make a good 3D Sonic game. So I'm not saying, I'm just not on the side of believing that Sonic can't be done right in 3D. I think it's Sonic Team that can't make Sonic right in 3D. That's what I'm saying.
By the way, I just what I literally heard you say was make Sonic into Ratchet so it actually works in 3D. Like, that's kind of bad if you think about it. Like, make it like another game so it works. You know,
they basically made a better 3D Sonic game than Sonic Team could.
Yeah, I disagree on that part because, you know, the weapons and all that shit fundamentally changes everything. You know, Ratchet is not really a melee. Ratchet is, I know he has a fucking wrench and all that, but he's not really a melee guy like that. Oh, go ahead, Chris. Who's trying to talk?
That was me.
Oh, go ahead, bro.
I was asking you, like, why? What is it that fundamentally can't work about a Sonic game in 3D in your opinion?
Literally play the last 20 years of it, and there's your answer. It just doesn't fucking work. There's something about the speed aspect that they can't. They just seem to just always funnel you through shit. Like, they can't seem to make it work somehow, as has been proven. You know what I'm saying? So, like, I'm not saying it's impossible, but they haven't shown me that they could do it yet. You know?
I feel like I hear Sonic fans, like, saying both of the, you know, the equivalent of saying, I want it smaller and bigger at the same time. You know, it feels like, okay, do you want to be, have open areas, or do you want to have, you know, highly, kind of designed courses? Because it can't really be both.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, they can't be both, you know?
Yeah.
Which is it that you want?
Oh, that's the thing. This is like a Superman game. I don't know the answer to that. I don't think
that there is an answer. But
you might be right.
Are you by definition wrong?
What happened?
Like I said,
Wait, say that. If there isn't an answer, what?
If there isn't an answer that makes you happy, are you by definition wrong?
No. How am I wrong?
Because you're asking for the impossible.
But I'm not asking for anything. I'm just asking, can
only the impossible would make you happy?
What the fuck are you talking about? I'm just saying, again, based on the past 20 years, it is clear to me that Sonic games do not work. I'm not asking for anything. Okay. I am stating what I observe. You're not actually disagreeing with Riku then.
You're just saying you haven't experienced them to work. It's not they fundamentally can't work. It's that you haven't seen them able to yet, but there's nothing inherently limiting about it that stops. Because here's my opinion.
Yeah, but no. By the way, you're doing that disagree to disagree bullshit, which irks me sometimes.
No, I'm not. Yeah. No, I genuinely feel there's a good answer here. Build it like a Tony Hawk game. That's what all of these games are designed around, right? And it's probably not going to be one main overworld, but like the whole point of a Tony Hawk game is to give you obstacles and things that you build and do at increasing speeds, right? You're supposed to build momentum and keep the momentum up. And that's the point of every Sonic game. And I've heard all people also saying that. Go ahead.
I got to push back. I don't understand this whole impossible to please shit. I'm just saying I haven't seen them do it. How am I impossible to please when I don't know how to do it? I don't know. If I knew the answers, I would actually state it. This is what I want. I don't know what the fuck. I don't know how this shit could work. So I don't understand what's the impossible to please part here.
Because if you're asking for conflicting things.
I'm not asking for anything. You're putting shit in there that isn't. Okay, I'm not asking for anything.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you would only be pleased by conflicting things, then there's
I'm not pleased by anything. I don't know where this pleasing stuff is coming from.
Okay, let's rewind. Remember when I asked you, I said, do you want it to be open world or do you want it to be curated? Right? Okay. And I said, because people ask for both of these things, and you can't have both of these things.
Fair enough. By the way, I didn't ask either of those. I'm not saying you specifically, but you literally said I am impossible to please.
I'm using you as a stand-in for the community here, man.
No, fuck it. I'm not. Fuck the community. I'm Tony. All right. Separate me from those motherfuckers.
Tony is out of this discussion because Tony doesn't even want a Sonic game. But for the people arguing. Oh,
by the way, real quick, Brett. You know what I do want? I actually have the answer for that. I got it. Sonic Origins. That's what I want. I'm good.
And you've got it.
Okay.
Yeah. You've got it, and he's happy.
Yeah. I'm happy with that.
Maybe the two people that should like continue this like debate in regards to 3D Sonic are probably the people that, you know, want to see more 3D Sonic.
Yeah, there you go.
We'll probably just be me and Brett here. I don't know if anyone else here cares.
Truth. Like, I think you and I are in agreement on a lot of the same things, but like, I think it can be done.
Here's the thing, though. You said that design it like a Tony Hawk game, right? Where you have like a giant playground of just shit that you can do in. And my response to that would be, that's sort of what the adventure stages were.
Yeah.
And when you look at Frontiers, how they have it set up where you have your action stages, or they're calling it the cyberspace stages, but they're the action stages from Sonic Adventure. And the place that you explore and unlock stuff and do all, and apparently level up Sonic and unlock different moves, apparently the spin dashes in there somewhere or something like that. But the fact is, the design of those open zone worlds is what they're calling it now, looks like a Tony Hawk's stage. Like, got the rails, the loop-de-loops and the ramps all over the place. So it's like, what you're saying is somewhat basically what they're doing right now with Frontiers.
Yeah, and I personally think they're taking a good approach to it. I agree with you saying, like, this seems like the spiritual successor to Sonic Adventure, which I think was the last one that it worked pretty well. I genuinely thought that I enjoyed the shit out of that game.
I do agree that there are aspects of Sonic Adventure that didn't age well, but me personally, I do think on a fundamental gameplay standpoint that it can be sound if it did get a remake, like on the level on the remake quality level of what, let's say, the Spyro remake got.
I think show me a Dreamcast launch game that didn't age.
That's a good question. I would say the only Dreamcast game I feel that didn't age is probably Soul Calibur 1. Soul Calibur 1 and Tony Hawk Pro Skater 2. Was it 2 on the Dreamcast or was it 3? I think it was 2.
Dreamcast was 1.
Okay, yeah. I feel like those are the only two Dreamcast games that probably are fine in regards to not aging. Everything else, yeah, I agree with. And you could probably make a debate for Dead or Alive 2 as well, but like, yeah, majority of the Dreamcast games did age poorly, so that's understandable to say that. But that's just like what I said in regards to, like, obviously me and Tony disagree on that, but in regards to Frontiers, I think I'm not going to say they're going in the right direction. I'm saying that they're going in the direction that I've been wanting them to go for since Sonic Adventure 2. And they haven't, because they've been going... I feel like the reason I haven't jumped back into Sonic was because the direction that they have been going in regards to the games, just looking at it from the outside, they look... What Tony was talking about in regards to, like, just looking at it and them just funneling through shit, I personally didn't feel Sonic Adventure was like that. I feel like that's what current Sonic was, where when I looked at it, it looked like a glorified Temple Run game, where it's just straight, and you may be straight to the left, you may be straight to the left. There was no ability to explore the level design, because it was literally a straight line, not like how Sonic Adventure was, where Sonic Adventure had knick-knacks within the level that you could play it two different ways. You could speed through the level in style, or you can like take it slow and find the hidden gems that were within the level. That doesn't exist in modern Sonic levels, you know? And it feels like Frontiers would have that, at least within its open zone stages. So,
no, I agree. I feel like Frontiers, like, I feel like Sonic Adventure tried to take a little bit of like open world exploring, but you know, here's kind of your different stages. And I feel like after that, they're like, you know, we should take some inspiration from racing games. And I just felt like that was always the wrong approach. Sonic on a track and make him go as fast as possible. And Sonic, Sonic's about speed, but it's about more than just speed.
I personally felt it was more so about agility than speed. That's what it felt like Sonic Adventure was. And you could probably make a debate with the original Sonic games on the 2D as well. Felt like it was more about agility and speed versus just speed, which that's what the other games were. That's why I'm not a fan of the whole boost formula. But another thing I wanted to talk about in regards to Frontiers that I liked in
Sonic Adventure, Sonic Adventure 2, and Sonic Heroes in particular, is combat. That's one thing that I actually enjoyed in Sonic Adventure, where you had, you know, you could charge, you could do the spin dash and charge up, and then do the ancient attack where he flies around and hits everyone with the homing attack, or in Sonic Adventure 2 where you had the fire somersault, or in Sonic Heroes you had like the cyclone. Sonic had combat capabilities, and it wasn't something that was like overly done. Like in Sonic Unleashed, you know, they had the whole Werehog thing and they tried to do a whole God of War type of combat and whatnot. That was too much, right? That was too much. But what Sonic Adventure and Sonic Heroes had, I felt like that was enough to showcase that, you know, Sonic, and he can hold his own, but in his way, right? And Sonic Frontiers looks like it's pushing around that level of combat as well. It's not going super deep into it, but it's showcasing that Sonic can do more than just spin dash and homing attack, right? So it's like, I like that aspect of it too. I'm willing to see more.
All right, cool. All right, let's continue with the Nintendo Directs. Good stuff. Blank, a console exclusive that features a fawn and a wolf cub. Okay. Return to Monkey Island is still coming to Switch later this year. Remember, we talked about Ron Gilbert getting harassed because fans. Let's see. Disney.
Hasn't this game been in making forever?
Yeah, I think that's what's upsetting them, you know.
God, I hate it when people hold me accountable for my deadlines, especially their self-imposed.
Yeah, well, you know, you don't want to harass either. You know what I'm saying? There's a way to do it.
No, I'm not saying that don't harass anybody. Just feel free to get a little bit pissy about it to yourself and maybe a couple of friends, and consider that pissiness when buying their products in the future. Like, I'm not saying, like, let's be honest, probably the last Monkey Island game you're ever going to fucking get. So, you know.
All right. Disney Dreamlight Valley. I don't know what that is. Early Access, what is this, a multiplayer game? No, whatever. Dragon Quest Treasures, what is this? Riku, any answers?
I was lightly paying attention to this. I think right now for me, it's like, my brain is like, one of the original Dragon Quest games coming back or making its way to a different platform, or if it's not Dragon Quest 12, I don't want to hear about it. So when my brain saw that, I'm gonna be honest, I fucking blanked out.
Fair enough.
About it.
Okay. By the way, a lot of these don't even have links, so I can't even look at trailers. Little Noah, Sign of Paradise, roguelike. You lost me right there. RPG Time, The Legend of Wright. Okay. What a bunch of trash, man. Lorelei and the Laser Eyes. Doraemon Story of Seasons. All right, here we go. Something I recognize. Mega Man Battle Network Legacy Collection. Isn't it something people... Riku, explain this to me, because I don't know what the hell Battle Network is.
Let's fucking go. So, Mega Man Battle Network. For anyone that knows me personally...
I thought you were going to say, for anyone who doesn't know me, I don't know what the fuck... Is this an online game by any chance?
Yes and no.
Okay. Anyway, go on. Explain the story.
So I'm a big Mega Man X fan, right? And when Mega Man X was on its way out, you know, Mega Man, I feel like after Mega Man X, Capcom made a decision to make Mega Man into a franchise that is more than just Mega Man and Mega Man X. Similar to how there's like multiple different Spider-Mans, I feel like after X, Capcom was like, we're going to make multiple different iterations of Mega Man that more or less have nothing to do with the previous versions. Sonic's kind of doing the same thing too at this point. But it's like, so after, you know, X, I'm like, all right, so I'm ready for the next Mega Man X, and they give us Mega Man Legends, and I'm just like, this isn't Mega Man X, but I'll play it, and I enjoyed it, right? I'm like, all right, so when is Mega Man X coming back? And they're like, the next Mega Man game is Mega Man... No, the first thing they said was an anime called Mega Man NT Warrior. I think it's standing for network transmission. I'm like, what the fuck is this? This isn't Mega Man X. This isn't even fucking Mega Man Legends. This is a new Mega Man. I didn't want to accept it, right? So in my head, I'm like, where's the next X game? I'm still not like understanding the concept that Capcom is trying to make Mega Man into different iterations of Mega Man at this point. They're pushing this Mega Man NT Warrior anime. I'm like, all right, I'll watch it, right? And, you know, the story's basically about a kid who... there's like this online... This is basically like an MMO online. You create your avatar and you go online and fight other characters' avatars. And, you know, his avatar is Mega Man. It's called Mega Man E... Mega Man.exe. You know, he's basically like a little AI file in the game, but that is their Mega Man. And, you know, all of the characters have their classic characters in that game's version. So they have a Proto Man over there. They have a Roll. They have a Guts Man. They have all of that shit, right? And, you know, the story is just them and the network, and they have the virus, and they have their own story and whatnot. And to be fair, it was actually pretty good, right? And, you know, they had a video game as well on the Game Boy Advance called Mega Man Battle Network. And it's different. It's like a action JRPG where you're on a like 9-panel grid and you fight these like virus monsters and whatnot. The gameplay, I'm telling you, just off of words, I cannot explain it to you. But what I can tell you is that these games are fucking fun as fuck, right? And it's unique as shit. They made 6 of them on the Game Boy Advance, and when they reached around the third one, they tried to do what you know, the Pokemon games does, where you know how Pokemon had a red version, a blue version, a gold and a silver version. So when they got around Mega Man Battle Network 3, they were like, okay, so there's a Mega Man White and a Mega Man Blue. And then they got to 4, and it was like Mega Man Red Sun and Mega Man Blue Moon, and 5 was Mega Man Team Proto Man and Mega Man Team Colonel, and then 6 was Mega Man Gregar and Mega Man Falzar. So, you know, they had their two different versions like Pokemon did, and the game sold like wildfire. And then, you know, they like I said before, they went on to something else after Battle Network 6. But as you can see, Capcom as of late has been trying to take all of the Mega Man games that they've made of yesteryear, wrap them up in a legacy collection, and re-release them to them. They did it with classic Mega Man, right? That was first. Then they did it with Mega Man X, and then they did it with Mega Man Zero, as far as I remember, right? So everyone was like, okay, so they're into Game Boy Advance games, because Mega Man Zero were a slew of Game Boy Advance games. Where's Battle Network? There's 6 of them. Give us a legacy collection. And people have been, well, not people, the Mega Man Battle Network fans have been asking for that for about, honestly, since these Mega Man Legacy Collection things that became a thing, right? So when they announced that, I was one of the people that were hype. A lot of underground Mega Man fans that really care for that shit are very happy that this shit exists. So I would look up some gameplay. You might not actually be sold by what you see, but I'm telling you right now, those games are fucking phenomenal.
Yeah, no, I've seen a lot of people on Twitter like hyped, like just in general, even before this was, and I was like, oh my god, Battle Network, where's it? I'm like, the fuck is Battle Network? Those, what is this shit?
Yeah,
you know,
interesting. Yeah, those are amongst some of my favorite Game Boy Advance games. I think 2 of them are in my top 10.
Wow,
6 and 3. Yeah, they're phenomenal.
High praise. All right,
it's coming to everything, not just Nintendo.
Yeah. Cool. All right. Where the hell are we? Mega Man. Okay. Super Bomberman R2 is coming. Cool.
That's cute.
If you like Bomberman. Pac-Man World Repack is a remake of Pac-Man World, and I don't even know what Pac-Man World is.
Really? So Pac-Man World originally came out on the PS1, and it's basically just a 3D platformer. You know, with the redesigned mascot version of Pac-Man, you know, the one with the legs and the arms and the whatnot. And he's actually in like a 3D platformer going through 3D platforming stages. And the game is actually received very well on the PS1. I played it. that is another game that's actually amongst some of my favorite PS1 games. That game is really good. I think it got three of them. Pac-Man World 2 came out on PS2 and GameCube, and then 3, I think, was the same thing. But they slowly... Some people say 2 is the best one in the franchise. I've only played 1, but everyone agrees that 3 is not that good. But I played 1. 1 was a great game. The fact that they're making a remake is good. That's a good game right there. There's a remake. This looks like it's a faithful remake as well. So that's a good one.
Cool. All right. Railgrade, a railway system builder, hit Switch. Okay.
Everything needs a simulator now, huh?
What happened?
Everything needs a simulator now, huh?
I guess, yeah. Captain Velvet Meteor, the Jump Plus Dimensions. What the fuck kind of title is that?
I can't help you there.
Yeah. And they said the Japanese Nintendo Direct announced Ultra Kaiju Monster Farm. Is that a kaiju farming simulator?
Sounds like it.
You know, why not? So, yeah, there you go. Nintendo. Being Nintendo.
It was definitely a mixed bag of, like, they had some great announcements, and then they had some, what the fuck is this shit? It was a mixed bag of stuff. But I would give this one a thumbs up.
Interesting. I think it's pretty clear what I would give it.
Yeah.
Absolutely. All right, we'll move on. A couple things here. We got some Steam Deck updates for you people. Yo, Carlos, man, you about to get yours, aren't you? Man, what's up?
Yo, man, getting it this weekend. I know Riku's been waiting for me to get this shit.
Oh, yeah, baby. Yeah, baby.
Now, why specifically Carlos? I already had my shit for like 2 weeks, man. Riku should have hit me up, bro.
I told Riku that once I get the Steam Deck, I'm going to be exponentially more motivated to finish up Trails. Chills in the Sky. So
the Legend of Heroes, baby.
Legend of Heroes.
You was telling me, and basically what Blander was saying earlier when I mentioned him in regards to Persona 5 on the Switch. People prefer to play their turn-based JRPGs in the palm of their hand. So it's like, you said you felt it would probably motivate you more to play, knowing that, you know, you got it in the palm of your hands, on the go, and all of that stuff. So
yeah. Especially older games and 2D indie games and, you know, JRPGs as well, because they're not graphically intensive games. So when I play them on my TV, and my PC monitors, it just looks, you know, stretched out. It doesn't look as good. So, you know, playing them on a handheld device kind of feels more natural for me. Also, I mean, when the Vita was still kicking, that was my go-to device for that type of stuff. And when the Switch was announced, I was excited as all heck, because I'm like, oh, Switch is about to be, you know, going to do what the Vita was supposed to do, or what would continue what the Vita is doing, but with a bigger screen, probably a bigger library, and the Nintendo games. You know, the dream died a little, you know. Not soon after it released, but now the Steam Deck is sort of replacing that, and it's like,
yeah, it's like at this point, if you're gonna play a Switch, you better be playing it for its first party games. You know, the games that are only on the Switch. It's like everything else, even from a portable standpoint, you could play it somewhere else better. You know, so it's like,
right,
if you're not playing Mario Odyssey or a Legend of Zelda, like, at this point, play it on the Steam Deck.
Yeah, and that's primarily what I do. The Switch, you know, just play first party games like the Metroids and the Marios and the Pokemon. So, but the Steam Deck, it's got my Steam library. It's got all my old games. A lot of, you know, there's a lot of old indie games that I still haven't played. Like that, I've always wanted to beat, like Antechamber, Mark of the Ninja. What else do I have? You know, there's just a whole bit, like Papers, Please. Like, there's a whole bunch of Steam games that, you know, that they're out there that I still haven't played. That that a lot of them I already freaking bought. So, you know, I don't have to pay $60 for an old game like I do on Nintendo.
Yeah, Steam.
You know, for For what is it? Brian of Isaac or Life of Brian Isaac? I forget what the name of the game's called.
Binding of Isaac. Life.
That one.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was like $60 when it released.
Crazy.
Nintendo.
The Nintendo tax man.
Can you just look at the difference? $100 versus Switch games versus $100 worth of Steam games will get you.
Okay.
Yeah. Them Humble Bundle packs will fucking
make you. Steam Deck is on sale right now. Going on right now, people. So you already know what to do. Get on it.
Oh, the Steam sales.
Yeah, Steam sale. My bad. Yeah, Steam sales is on. Is going on right now. So you already know.
Yeah, you know, on Twitter, I asked people they have any recommendations of any mainly indie focused games. They had any suggestions? So, you know, anybody here in the chat or anybody in the panel, if they have an indie game, I'm not asking Tony for a particular reason.
Yeah, you know.
But, but if anybody has any suggestions, you know. Shoot them out to me. I'm interested.
Yeah, let them know in the chat. Indie games, go.
Yeah, I actually have a good indie game something that you should check out, Carlos. This title called Linklick.
I'm on my Steam right now.
I have to scroll way up.
Link.
Carlos, you ruined the joke.
Oh, my bad. I was taking. Okay, so. My bad. It flew over my head. What happened?
Linklick.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I knew it sounded familiar. I'm like, that sounds like something I heard before. Okay, now it all makes sense. Yep. So Brian recommended an anime not too long ago, and it's called Linklick.
And then this motherfucker wants to play games instead. So I'm like, no. You watch this anime.
Yo, man. You know, Gabe is hand delivering this.
Oh, nice. I'll back up a recommendation that Brian made to me of Carrion.
Oh, yeah. Go for it. It might still be on Game Pass, actually.
Oh, that's and that's funny you say that, because that's an interesting thing. It's like, okay, so, you know, might play all these games on the Steam Deck, but I'm like, I wonder if some of them already came out for Game Pass. And I'm like,
you can play them on Game Pass on your Steam Deck.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to see how that's gonna play. Hopefully it's pretty good compatibility.
Yeah. All right. Go ahead.
One last thing. I'm actually kind of torn that Adam isn't the first one to get this. No offense, Tony.
Yeah.
But if Adam would have been the first one to get it, by the time we would have gotten it. We would have gotten all the hookups.
Oh, absolutely. That's just a fact. That's just a fact. Adam, he knows all that shit, you know?
But you've been all up and around telling everything.
Adam's going to probably be the last guy that gets it here, and then he'll lap us in within a week, you know? I got the hookups.
I got the hookups. You don't want to get that easy.
I got all the butter games.
The butter games. Kyle, you know, I'm going to call this the Steam Deck Guadalupe, and she talks to me, you know, and got in a fight the other day with Dutch.
You know, but Carlos, since you're getting yours, are you worried about this other situation that's going on with the Steam Deck right now? It seems that the specs have changed without anybody noticing until somebody caught on. Okay, so apparently... like newer versions of the Steam Deck. Okay, let's go back. So the existing ones, you know, either the 256 or 512 gigabyte ones. By the way, well, don't get the one with 64 gigs. That's just a waste of your fucking money, you know. They have, four lanes, right? Now, apparently, the new ones only have two lanes. So apparently, you know, some people are worried I could slow shit down. Valve says it's fine. Everything's cool, but... You know, people are worried. So are you worried that the one you get may be a little slower?
Yeah, that's interesting. I don't even know what to think.
Yeah.
Because it's...
Okay, let me give you some more information, because I really like people discussing this. Does anyone actually know the differences in speed between having it be two lanes and four lanes?
Well, the thing is, the way that this article explains it, it's like the the hard drives that we're using on the existing ones and the newer hard drives, like, they kind of equal each other out. That's the way they explained it, right? But SSDs. Obviously, Brian, yeah, the SSDs, but Brian, obviously, you could explain this a lot better than even me, you know? So break it down, please.
All right. So I've been seeing people getting, like, slightly upset about this, and I'm just like, do people actually know the differences, or are people just upset because it's less, so hence they're thinking that they're getting less of a product?
Brian, can I stop you right now? Remember the whole CUDA core thing? Well, people just see numbers. Oh, the numbers are higher. That's it. It's better. You know?
Got to get the CUDA cores.
CUDA cores, again. Yeah, go ahead, Brian. Okay.
So basically, the whole lanes is just how much speed. But again, it's highway lanes. Just that's the best example. So you have four lanes. Traffic. You have two lanes, you get half the traffic. That's just how things work. So the same thing here. You get two lanes, it's half the speed as four lanes. But that's not the important part. The important part is, okay, so how fast are the actual throughput of those four lanes? So the drives, 3.0 drives at four lanes is going to be roughly 4,000, or to be exact, 3,940 megabytes per second. So hence, the two lanes is roughly 1,970. So for shits and giggles, let's just say 4 and 2 gigs per second, since numbers are easier that way. So you're getting about 2 gigs per second worth of throughput, which is not that bad if you consider things. So let's look at the competitors. Well, I say competitors. Let's look at other places. Well, let's look at other places. So if you take the PS5, that has a maximum throughput of 5.5 gigs per second. So it's relatively, like, competitive. Even going as far as the Xboxes, which has, depending whether it's compressed or raw, it can be from 2.4 to 4.8. So even if you take, like, the minimum number of 2.4, you are essentially getting a drive that's slightly slower than the Xbox Series X and X in terms of speed. So it's still incredibly competitive. And if you want to actually see just how much of a leap that is, the hard drives in, like, the last gen, so the Xbox One and PS4, they are measured in megabytes per second. Jesus. So they are 120 megabytes per second. So 0.12 compared to 2 is like a 20 times more throughput. So yes, it is going to be slower, but I don't think that most people will actually notice the difference, because it's still going to be incredibly fast speeds. So hence why I'm like, I read it and I was like, oh, this sounds concerning, and then I seen the numbers and it's like, okay, it doesn't seem that concerning now. So again, I don't trust Valve saying that there is no speed difference. I'm pretty sure there's bound to be a speed difference, but I think the speed difference will be in fractions of a second, to the point where you don't even notice the difference. So that's why I'm not overly concerned.
Yeah, that was kind of my takeaway too, Brian. Like, when I first read, I was like, hold on, well, this sounds bad. And then, you know, when I read, I was like, oh, wait, actually not really. Like, the normal person probably won't notice this shit.
I mean, if you even look at, like, PS5 speeds compared to Xbox Series S speeds, like, it's pretty different. But yet, the games load in, like, fractions of seconds, sometimes more. But it's still in measurable of, like, factors of less than 10 seconds or 20 seconds difference.
Yeah.
And that's, like, two vastly different things. So, yeah, I think the difference for this will just be not that big. Because, again, these aren't 4K machines blasting out X many textures, so hence you don't really need that much throughput in the first place. So
yeah,
I honestly don't think it will make a difference. And plus, I did see a video where someone compared the Steam Deck with the SSD and the Steam Deck with the SD card, so the 64 gig and the 512 gig, and even then the load speeds were not that different. I think,
oh really, like, interesting,
3 or 4 seconds different, which is 3 or 4 seconds, but then again, it's that much different.
Yeah, that's interesting.
So, yeah, it just, again, I personally don't see a big deal in getting upset. And if it really does affect you that much and you really, really, really don't like it, then just get the one with four lanes.
Yeah.
Like, again, you can still swap out the SSD yourself afterwards.
Yeah, that is true. So, yeah, because I was going to ask, like, do we know if the one with four links will be available after the fact? Or, like, do you have to buy an older model? Like, how is that? Obviously, like you said, you could just swap it out yourself anyway, you know? But will Valve continue releasing those? Because they said that you have to check the specific model number to see which one you have.
My guess is it's kind of like how you get like revisions of consoles, where like even with the PS5, like they made the new version or new revision that has like the smaller heatsink in it, and it came out like a couple months afterwards.
Yeah, that's right. We talked about that. Yeah,
I think it would just be a case of anything that's already out or in storage or shipping out like this month, next month, will be the old ones, and the new ones will be stuff afterwards. Because didn't they say that they are planning like a ramp up speed?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, ramp up
production.
Yeah, that's the one. So my guess is that they were able to get the ones with two lanes a lot easier, hence they can speed up more units.
Yeah. That's a good point. Interesting stuff, man. So Carlos, again, to ask you, does this worry you?
No, especially considering the reason why, one of the biggest reasons why I'm getting the Steam Deck is to play indie games.
Yeah.
And JRPGs, and that doesn't really, it's not really relevant. Also, when it comes to, you know, if maybe that kind of stuff, it would be important for the PlayStation, especially since, you know, that's something that they doubt, you know, Cerny and all that stuff. It would be kind of dicey, you know, but... Not for this system. I wouldn't take into account. And yeah, and the reason why I didn't have an opinion before is because before Brian broke it down, I didn't know what the throughput was for each of the, you know, the channels. I'm like, okay, it's 2 versus 4, but are they equal?
You know, yeah. So it's, but you know how people are simple. It's like you see 2 or 4, like, oh shit, you know, without taking all the other factors into account. You know, simple minded fanboys. You know.
Now this is also, again, this is theoretical. Like, most things can't use up enough bandwidth to take up
four
lanes.
That's also true.
So like, that's a shitload of bandwidth all at once. Most likely, I'm speaking purely speculatively here, but most likely there's going to be a bottleneck somewhere else in the system before that becomes an issue.
Yeah, we're not running Ratchet and Clank in this system.
Wait, what about Ratchet and Clank? I love Ratchet and Clank.
Yeah, there you go. I don't know, man. This is semi-related but unrelated. I call these stunt testing, you know? Like, what was it? This dude put out this video where he tried to, like, where he transcoded 8K video of the new MacBook Pro. It's like, oh, it reached 108 degrees. I'm like, yeah, no shit, because you're doing something that no regular person would be doing on it. You know, I like, to me, I just consider that type of shit stunts, you know? So this type of thing, you know, I don't know. It just seems stunty to me, you know?
Again, just going back on the Mac thing. Like, yes, it is a stunt, but I think it's also, like, a worst-case scenario type thing.
Also, like, but Ryan, just get the fucking MacBook Pro, you know, the 14-inch one or 6-inch, and call it a day if you really need to be doing shit like that, you know?
Okay, I think if it's... Okay, when I see stuff like that, I just see it more as a case of these guys are just testing it to the extreme, to, like, see, like, okay, like, can it do these things that people, for the most part, won't ever do, but still... Someone out there might want to do that, or someone that one person may have that need. So it's for that one person who says, okay, I want to do 8K transcoding, so can it handle it? So for that one person, it kind of makes sense. For everyone else, it's just kind of like fancy to look at and say, okay, it can do that. That's nice to know, you know?
Yeah, silly. By the way, it's like, change this design, Apple, please. Like, this shit's fucking old. Anyway, let's move on to the next story. Rico, I'm glad you're here for this one.
Yeah.
Need to hear your opinions on this. So, the Final Fantasy 16 developers say that realistic graphics don't mesh well with turn-based mechanics. And, you know, this is why he's saying that. That's not his opinion. He says that gamers generally... won't accept turn-based combat with realistic graphics, and that's why with Final Fantasy 16 they're going full on action. Yeah.
But dude, Final Fantasy is the ones that made the cinematic games that pushed the boundaries of what was possible by keeping them turn-based.
I would. Here's what I would say to that. First of all, Final Fantasy X says fuck you, right?
Yeah.
Secondly, what metric or examples of these games is he using to make such an argument or statement?
Oh, I'm not sure, but again, this is just all anecdotal.
I understand.
You know, generally speaking, I'm not talking about outliers. I'm talking because me and you were outliers. We love our turn-based shit. You know?
No, I understand. But I understand too.
Like you've heard it. Like, you know, people generally don't like turn-based. So, like, I want full-on action. You know?
No, I understand that. What I'm saying is that, lately, in regards to the turn-based JRPG big dogs, they have all been cel-shaded anime style. So, with him saying such a statement, I'm assuming that there are realistic turn-based JRPGs out there that you can point to and be like, see that right there? I don't want that. And what I'm saying is that where are these that you can point and say that to? Because majority of them have been cel-shaded anime style. Dragon Quest, Persona, even Trails, like all of them, all of the big ones that you can think of are all anime styled. That doesn't necessarily mean that we don't want realistic turn-based. I'm sure everyone here would love a Final Fantasy that looked as good as it does now, but plays like Final Fantasy X in, you know, with modern related stuff, right? That's a no-brainer. But we don't have that. So it's like, I don't understand where he's getting that from. That's all I'm saying.
Because I understand exactly where he's getting it. He's getting it from the community, people who hate turn-based shit, you know? I see it all the time.
I would say the only people saying that are people that don't like turn-based overall, regardless of how it looks.
Yeah, but that's kind of the main. But that's the mainstream, though. They want immediate action. You know, they don't want to wait. They want it now. Understand? I understand your frustration, but I'm looking at things the way they actually are. Like the actual average gamer. They don't like turn-based. It's more of a niche thing. I understand Persona and shit is very popular. I get that. But Final Fantasy is even more popular, you know? There's a reason why, you know?
How many people do you think...
Yeah.
How many people do you think's first JRPG was Final Fantasy VII and /
Oh, yeah. Again, it's turn-based. But again, look at the world around you now. If turn-based was still the, you know, wanted, every game would still be turn-based, right? Like you notice the shift. We're all going towards action, and I've said this many times on the show. I am not happy about that.
I think the thing is,
but it is what it is. You know,
when it comes to Square and Final Fantasy in particular, the original developers behind Final Fantasy, since day one, have admitted all the way back since Final Fantasy I when they were making that they never wanted to make this franchise turn-based to begin with. The only reason they did was because of the limitations of what the NES could do at the time.
Did they actually say that?
They did say that.
You need to link me to that, because that's a bunch of BS. Like, there were actually action RPGs back then. Then Dragon Quest came around and changed the whole landscape, you know? So if anything, it's because of Dragon Quest's popularity, not because of limitations. RPGs back then, too. As a matter of fact, there were the majority of them until Dragon Quest came and changed shit up, you know? But if you find that, please link me to it.
Yeah, I'll find you that, because like I said, they said they've been trying to change that. That's why ATB even became a thing, because they were trying to find a hybrid between turn-based and making the player.
Oh, yeah. By the time ATB came around with Final Fantasy IV, that turn-based was fully entrenched, you know? It was already a thing. But you know, I do understand where he's coming from, although I would prefer. Like, Final Fantasy VII Remake, that would have been fucking awesome as turn-based, but... You know, the demands of... Yeah.
They kind of have that, like, weird mobile... Little bit. Yeah, one that exists, but... Yeah. One that's something a little...
But they said even for this one, 16, they're going to go even further with the action stuff, you know? Yeah. So, yeah, kind of interesting. By the way, it's in, even I'm reading his statement. He ultimately says, like, yeah, like, you know, we were trying to figure out what to do, and then the higher-ups were like, gamers don't like that shit. Make it action. It's like, all right, there you go. But it's true, just seeing what I... Just being around gamers for, like, ever, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, they were like I used to be when I was a teenager. I was like, fuck all that shit. I want it now, you know? But it is what it is, man. And the last thing we're going to discuss tonight, I'm actually wearing something right now. So this week, Sony announced a new brand of that's going to be making gaming hardware, specifically, you know, in this case, monitors and headsets, but I'm going to assume they're going to do other shit too. It's called Inzone. Just a little bit of background. I've known about this for like a month now, right? I got the like a email from Sony about a month ago. They're like, do you want to come to this Sony gaming event? And I was just like, there's no PlayStation here. What do you mean Sony gaming? What the fuck are you talking about? You know? So I go to the event and, you know, they give us the whole spiel. But yeah, it's basically... the Inzone line is meant to be Sony is trying to encroach themselves into PC gaming, which makes sense, right? They've already started releasing software on PC, so it stands out that a hardware company would want to make hardware for PC. So they released the Inzone M9 gaming monitor, and the M3 is going to be coming out later on, I believe. And then you have three headsets, the H9, which I'm wearing right now, H7, H3, and they're going to be out later on. I think July they're coming out. Kind of interesting, but it's funny how they're not using the PlayStation branding. They specifically, because I asked them about this, I was like, okay, what are you guys? They said they are not affiliated with Sony Interactive Entertainment at all. But obviously, you look at these things, what do they look like? They look like PlayStation 5, you know? So it's kind of interesting. And when I was at the event, it was actually, like, it was very clear to me that they are directly competing with, like, you know, other monitor manufacturers. Like, for example, they had the Sony monitor here, and then they had an LG right next to it, and, you know, they wanted me to do a comparison. By the way, this is something I should have asked at the event. I'm like, who's making the panels for you then? Because LG, you make a lot of panels. I'm like, is LG making your panels and you're doing a comparison? But I did notice that the Sony one, and obviously these motherfuckers could have tweaked the settings, right? With the LG, the Sony one just had more vibrant colors and stuff. The LG kind of looked washed out. Then when they showed it next to this other Samsung monitor, initially the Samsung monitor looked nicer because it was more colorful. But then they said that the Sony one has more accurate natural colors and stuff, which was kind of interesting. And I think the M9, you know, a 4K 144 hertz to HDMI 2.0, which is very important, for $899. Not too bad, especially when you get more expensive monitors and shit. No OLED or anything like that. But I think it's pretty good. As for these headsets, they're good. I like them better than the Pulse 3D headsets, because every single time I've used them, everybody said, Tony, you sound like shit. You know, but as Rico, as you could attest, you know, we did a test tonight and you said I sounded good. A little thin, I think, but overall pretty good. They're very comfortable. Although, as you can see, they're kind of big, you know, that I look a little ridiculous wearing these things. But overall, I think it's pretty cool that Sony is doing this, and I'm curious to see if they're going to do like gaming mice, maybe keyboards. Like, let's go all in, Sony. Let's really do it, you know. So Rika, what's your take on the whole Inzone thing? I want to get your take specifically because, like, you know, as just a regular fan, like, because I know there were leaks, like, I think last week, like, hey, Sony's coming out with this new shit. I had to keep my ass shut. I don't want to say nothing. Yeah. So what's your take on this whole Inzone line?
So the whole Inzone line, I think with them, because, you know, before what we have now, there was a lot of accessories, especially in the PS4 era, where a third-party company would make a specific accessory for PlayStation, and PlayStation would quasi put their seal of approval on it, and it would try to somewhat trick the people who aren't really in the know in that stuff into believing that this is an official PlayStation accessory that they should grab when in actuality it's just a yet another third party accessory that has a Sony seal of approval stamp on it. It doesn't make it any more special than any of the other third party PlayStation accessories that don't have that stamp on it. So it's like this generation, with them doing this, it definitely feels like this is far more connected into being closer to feeling like an official PlayStation Sony accessory than the ones that they partnered, quote unquote, partnered with prior. For me, that headset in particular, it's too little too late for me in particular. Remember I was telling you about, you know, the headset that I had. I was going through a phase when Sony first had its headsets, like, you know, all the way back to the fucking Jabra Bluetooth headset that came with Warhawk. I had that, the official Bluetooth little earpiece that came with that PS3 had with the little charging stand, and then the one after that with the stereo headset one, and then the Pulse 3D. I think the Pulse 3D was the last one I had, or I had the one after that, the first one for the PS4. But after that, I just came to the conclusion that these Sony headsets, even though they're first party, their durability just was not it. They could not last past like 2 years. The shit would always crack and break down, and I would have to get another one. So after that one, I just gave up. I was just like, Sony just can't make fucking headsets. And I think a lot of people during that time came to that same conclusion.
Yeah, I need to jump in real quick. Kind of interesting, because they make like good headphones, you know? Yeah,
that's weird. Because it's like, and that's the thing, there's definitely two different development teams when it comes to making their accessories. There's PlayStation side that makes the PlayStation stuff, but then there's the Sony side that makes, you know, stuff for Sony that's not PlayStation. So like their TVs, basically everything that's not PlayStation, you know. So all of those headsets over there that are made from the ground up to be used for literally everything that's not a PlayStation, those are good. They've always been good in every aspect, especially durability. But on the side of the PlayStation and the ones that they've been making for PlayStation in specific, they just have not been holding up from a durability standpoint ever, right? And that's, and I feel like that's been the case all the way up to the ones that you have on your head. It ends there, where that one seems like it's breaking that cycle of this very bad stigma that the PlayStation headsets have been sullied with.
Yeah, gaming headsets, we should say. No, and I need to jump in just to make this clear, because this is interesting. Remember, I'm still kind of new to the tech journalism side, right? But when I went to the event with my colleague Kate, she was like, "Oh, the Sony monitor guy is heading this thing. Oh, the Sony headset guy is heading this thing." So this is not made by PlayStation, obviously. It's made by the people who have done these products, Rico, which is, you know, to your point, it's like, that should make you feel a little bit more relief. Like, these headsets aren't made by PlayStation. They're made by the people who make the Sony headsets. The monitors are made by the guys who make Sony TV. So that's
exactly.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a very good point to make right there.
Yeah, the fact that there is a clear distinction between the two production teams, in that the one that's been doing the good production is finally making headsets for the gaming side, the side that I would say for the past decade and a half, they've definitely been up on the rise in regards to sales that you can make off of a headset. I'm sure the audiophiles are out there still getting their headsets, but if someone said that most of the headsets being bought in the past decade have been gaming headsets, I don't think anyone here would like be hard strung to not believe that, you know? So it's like, yeah, they should have been doing this from jump, but I guess better late than never. But like I said, for me, I'm already over here with the Turtle Beach. A lot of people are already over there with the Steel Series. So it's like, at this point, if you don't have one of those headsets already, and you're still one of those people having, you know, messing around with those PlayStation headsets, this, I guess, would be, not even guess, this is definitely your best bet moving forward if you're going to continue with the PlayStation first-party headsets. But then another question that they would have to ask themselves is, are they ready to make that jump in regards to pricing? Because all of the headsets that were made for PlayStation prior to that one never passed the $200 mark, right? As far as I remember, the highest they've ever went was $179 at most. Majority of them were $150, some were $120.99. They stayed around under $200, which, how much is that one, Tony?
$300.
Yeah. So it's like, that is something that if you're someone who has been still trying to give these PlayStation headsets a chance, and if you had one, you've had every iteration up to that point, this was going to be the biggest investment that you're going to be making moving forward with that one. And it's, and as far as I'm hearing, it seems worth it, right?
In my opinion, it is. I've been using these things for like 2 weeks. They're fucking legit. They're not the best headsets I've ever used, but they're the best Sony headsets I've ever used by far. Yeah. You know?
32 hours of battery life. The quality seems good. The durability seems good. Like, yeah, it seems like you would be getting, I wouldn't necessarily be saying you'll be getting a bang for your buck, but it seems like people who decide to get that headset will be satisfied with the headset that they get. And it should be a headset. I think this is the most important part. It should be a headset that should last you the rest of this generation. Because that's a big problem, like I said, that the previous headsets have had. In my opinion, they could not last you over 2 years, no matter how good you took care of them. They're going to, wear and tear is going to fuck them up. They always will, right? And it doesn't seem like that one, that's going to be the case with that one. And it shouldn't for that price.
Yeah. I mean, you know, obviously this thing's just like, kind of just came out. Actually, are they available to the public yet? I'm not sure. But, you know, obviously we'll see in a few months how well they last. Because you're right, those Pulse headsets, man, those motherfuckers did not last, you know. But we'll see. But, yeah, no, the Inzone line, very interesting. Because obviously this is just the beginning. So I'm curious to see what else they bring. Like, even though I like the M9, the gaming monitor, I want to see, like a OLED or Q, you know, a D OLED could be, like, from them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, and staying on the topic of PlayStation accessories, another thing that I've been hearing a big rumor about, and you probably know about it. If you can't say anything, then, you know, you don't got to say nothing. But as far as I've been hearing, from my insiders,
excuse me,
they Sony over there actually trying to do something when it comes to making a DualSense Pro. So now that's what I'm hearing.
Okay, and I'll just say this: I have not heard this before. This is interesting. Okay. And Rico, I guess I could say if I just kept quiet, I would have probably said something. But no, I've never heard this. Please tell me that the rumors are saying it's gonna have back paddles or something. You know,
that's what I'm hearing in regards to the rumors, is that it's supposed to have the two things that it is confirmed to, that they're working on, is a controller that has back paddles and a better battery. I'm not sure what some people are saying. Oh, yeah, swappable analog. I'm not entirely sure in regards to that one. But as far as I'm hearing, back paddles are definitely on it, and a better battery is something that is in it.
That does sound really quite cool, like a controller with haptics and back paddles, man. Yeah. Imagine. Yeah, really nice, like, hold one of those, right? Wait.
Yo, Scuff, where you at?
I know, right?
Nonetheless. The Steam controller.
Oh, that is also true. Oh, damn.
Yeah. Nonetheless, that's definitely something that the PlayStation, that's, like I said, that's something that they really haven't tackled. Is a premium controller. You know, Xbox has been doing it since, what, the 360 era? Pro controllers? First-party pro controllers? Or maybe that was just Xbox One. Point is, they've been doing it for a while, and PlayStation. It seems like they're going to be working on a pro controller. I hope that rumor is true. Apparently, we should hear something either this month or next month in regards to.
Don't get the fanboys excited. You know what'll happen if that doesn't happen. You know.
Hey man, fanboys, y'all know where I'm at. Square the fuck up.
Yeah, that's it. You gonna send you dick pics?
Oh god, time to close my DMs.
You know. Oh man,
that's just what I'm hearing. We shall see when if that shit come out, man. I'm gonna be back on here. We could talk about it.
We could talk about that.
We'll you know talk about that.
Oh man, all right. I think that's it for us, man. Another good show.
Oh wait, what's up,
Chris? Excuse me.
What, Tony?
Well, I was just wondering because I had the same experience with Rico with my gold headset, but my Pulse headset has not fallen apart yet. I've been fortunate.
How long have you had it for?
I got it. Carlos had told me when it was available. I bought it a few months after I got the PS5.
Okay, so about 2 years then, right? Close.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's been holding up. My gold headset, though, just like.
Yeah. That's what I meant. It was the gold headset. Fucking bullshit.
It was very sad, too. It was the. It was themed like a classic PlayStation, was the gray one.
Yeah.
Here's the thing, though. The Pulse ones that I was talking about were on the PlayStation 3. I think its name in particular was called Pulse Elite. It's called Pulse Elite.
Oh, okay.
And it was like it had like a silver band around the top, and it had the ability. I don't know if the later ones did this. I don't think they did. But that one in particular, the reason they called it the Pulse was because of the fact that that one had some sort of like rumble feature within the headset where, you know, if a loud thing did happen, the headset would rumble and it was supposed to do some sort of immersion thing. It sort of worked.
Oh, but okay.
I think that was the last PlayStation headset that I had. And it was called the Pulse Elite. But then I think they eventually made another one called Pulse, and then it didn't have the Elite name associated with it. But that was the one I was talking about.
Okay. Let's
see if I can try to find a picture.
But yeah, the gold ones are trash.
Yeah,
gold was trash. I've had it so far so good with the current Pulse headset on PS5. I'm just saying that.
Yeah, again, I'm wondering if like either mine is fucked up or I didn't set it right, because when I've tried it, all you guys in the chat are like, "Yo, Tony, you sound like shit," you know. So
man.
I don't know. So I'm like, "Damn, man, I spent $100 on this shit." You know, I'm still rocking these Sennheisers. Everybody says I sound great on these, but maybe these will be my daily drivers now, you know?
Yeah. And I just posted a picture of like the one.
Oh, damn. No. You know, yo, man, you talking shit about my Samsung mic, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, if you guys look in the chat, that was the one that I was referring to.
Which one? Oh, yeah.
Oh, you posted it on the chat.
In the chat, excuse me?
You probably seen it.
Is somebody playing ping pong in the background? What the fuck?
That's my cat slapping the blinds around.
The cats.
So are those going to replace the ones that you're wearing, Tony? Are they going to replace the Sennheisers?
They might. We have to do more testing, you know. We shall see. You know, whenever we game again, whatever. There's no games right now, though, you know.
I don't know. I'm talking about during Throwdown.
Well, I never actually used a Sennheiser. I use these HyperX. That's what I normally use for Throwdown. But I think I will use these just because I'm not wired anymore, you know? Yeah.
Wait, I got a question for Carlos.
Why is it?
Now that Steam Deck is going to get you to play some of your backlog, when are you going to finish?
I know where this is going. I knew it.
When you finishing that motherfucking Demon's Souls, you know?
When he finishes Link Click.
All right, hurry up and watch that.
When he finishes all the trail.
Well, you got a lot of shit to finish. You know?
No beer till you finish your tequila.
I got a long list, man.
see, Carlos, I don't put any demands on you, man. You do what you want, you know.
And I appreciate you for that. Neither does Manny. Adam puts a lot of more demands.
Yeah.
Yeah. The thing with Demon Souls. If I go through the Sealy tours, it'll be done within an hour. So we need to configure that.
Take the tour, motherfucker.
I gotta take the tour because I told Chris the other day I tried to play Demon Souls the other day, and man, was that rough. Just because I kept comparing it, my visuals just kept comparing it to Elden Ring.
Funny, because I think from a
graphically, I still think the Demon Souls remake looks superior to Elden Ring.
But you think that Sonic 3D is superior to the 2D, so...
I don't think that's comparable from a graphical standpoint.
No, I know. I'm just joking.
Yeah, I know you were. I'm just saying in regard... I don't know. I remember looking at Elden Ring. It was like, Elden Ring looks good for a PS4 game, but like... It plays better and it moves better, but I don't think it looks better.
I feel like
you're looking at Knight's armor and the graphical fidelity on like the wall and everything.
Oh yeah,
dragons and all of that stuff. Demon's Souls remake still has it.
Yeah, I think you might be right about the graphical fidelity. I just like the, I don't know, maybe I don't know.
If Elden Ring has a better aesthetic. You can say
that. Aesthetic. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I can see where you're coming from, Carlos, with the combat is clunkier. I mean, it's a much older game.
Yeah, that's a faithful remake. So, like, yeah, it still has, other than the ability to roll in four extra different directions, ain't shit changed for Demon's Souls.
Yeah.
So, I'm grateful that we have an extended weekend. So maybe I can, at least, you know, check one off the list. Yeah, which one it'll be, we will see.
Like if I call us play, I'm playing the Stanley Parable.
It was only the Stanley Parable.
The Stanley Parable, hey, Marvel fans.
Bring me Spider-Man.
We all know that motherfucker's going to be back on Heroes of the Storm.
Oh, on Steam Deck,
excuse me. The service
on the Steam Deck. No, that's impossible. I mean, it has a trackpad, but. No, I haven't played Heroes of the Storm.
He was playing chess on the Steam Deck.
You got your ass.
That's a possibility.
This motherfucker bought, how much, you bought the high-end one, right? The $600 one, Carlos?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're going to spend all that money to play chess, bro?
Yeah, man. Yeah. Oh, by the way, I do have a last thing to mention.
Yo, Carlos, don't worry about it, man. I spent $1,000 on his iPhone. I just tweet on it all day, you know? So it is what it is.
Yo, man. But it looks nice.
Yo, look at it. 120 frames. You excuse me? You know? Anyway, go on.
Yo, man, I still don't know. We'll talk that. I'll talk off air. But the thing that I was going to mention is, so remember I was telling you that my parents are doing a remodeling thing in their home. So we bought them a new TV, and we got a Samsung. And I'm like, oh shit, Samsung's about to get an update. Xbox is going to have Game Pass on the Samsung TVs.
That's right. The Samsung Gaming Hub is called.
Yes.
What else? Twitch is coming to it. Luna is coming to it. You know? Pretty interesting. We told you motherfuckers this was going to happen. We told you, you know?
So that's a Miss Cleo moment. But another thing, I'm like, let me go test it out. Because they came out today. The TVs from 2021. And apparently the update's only for 2022 models.
Oh, that's right. Oh, damn.
And I'm like, fuck.
They walled you off, son.
Yo, man, why are they racist?
Race Mexicans, man. It's racist motherfuckers, man.
A question about the TV. Does it come with Stadia?
Oh. Was that a rhetorical question?
Possibly so, yeah.
It does not come with Stadia. Oh, well, actually, I didn't check. I could check the maybe some other day. I can look for the apps, but it doesn't come with it pre-built. I will say that. Yo, man, you know what's horrible? TVs ask you to sign into their service. Come on, man, that's enough with that. Yeah. That's pretty much it.
But yeah, no, you're right. 2022 TV, Samsung's.
Yeah, man.
Yo, man, Korea, what's up, you know?
Yo, what's up, man?
All right, anything else you guys want to say before we wrap it up?
No, I'm good. I don't think we have any. Since the normal people that plug in stuff.
Yeah, are, no, are nothing games. To plug, man. You know, actually, no, fuck, I'll plug some shit. You know.
Oh.
Go to Tom's Guide and read my review of the Sony Inzone M9. A very good gaming monitor for you to consider. $100,000 $100,000 So not bad at all, you know. But sometimes I when I do reviews of shit, sometimes I wonder if my New Yorkism fucks shit up. Cause I'm like, eh, $800, that's not bad, you know. But I'm like, everything's expensive, you know. Cause like when I was telling my boss about it, he was like, how much does it cost? I was like, $899. He's like, you know, but like, that's good. Like, I reviewed monitors that cost $1,500, you know, like it ain't, it is good for its price, you know, with all the features you get. So go check out my review. And obviously I'll be reviewing the headsets very soon. The review is almost done. I just got to send it over, get some more pictures, you know,
in comparison. And Tony might know this. How much does Apple's XDR monitors cost?
Oh my God.
Aren't they like $4,000?
Yeah, they are $4,000, exactly. Yeah. So yeah, come on now.
Yeah, so Sony ain't so bad, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I'm like, yo, this shit costs half as much as my TV. That's not bad at all, you know? Although my TV,
You also have to take into consideration the demographic they're selling it to.
Yeah.
When it comes to gamers, there's obviously some sort of specific price threshold that they try to stay around. You know,
yeah, like exactly.
People outside buying stuff that isn't associated with gaming, they are willing to pay up to $1,000+ for
majority. Yeah, things. And this is under $1,000. They do have the other monitor coming out, the M3. The difference with that one is it's full HD 1080p and I forgot the hertz, but it's like 240 hertz. That's like the main difference. But it's like you get more hertz, but but you don't get the nice quality, you know. So I would suggest the M9. You know, it's worth it. Don't take into my New Yorkness into account. To me, that's an affordable fucking monitor, man. You know, gaming monitor. Yeah. So yeah. Good stuff. Oh yeah, no plugs other than that. So let's wrap it up here. Riku, do you want to plug anything? Actually, where can people find you?
Yeah, you can find me on the Twitter @RikuSun1. That's all I got to plug for you people.
Don't you have a RPG podcast? You guys do?
Yeah, we have a. I'm over at a JRPG podcast. If you want to check it out, it's called the HPMP podcast on YouTube. Owner Shadow Elite. He's been MIA, but we still do episodes. We do like one or two a month, you know, because it is specifically about JRPGs. So whenever the news of JRPGs rack up, then we'll get together and, you know, talk about it, give our opinions on it, what we're looking forward to, what we're playing, all that stuff. So it's not something that is as consistent as the Throwdown over here.
You already know. Two episodes a week, baby.
Yeah, these guys on it, man. I respect the consistency.
Yeah, you already know. We're going to have more episodes in the Warzone coming up soon, you know?
Oh.
That may or may not be a clue about what we're doing for episode 400. Just saying.
Oh, you know? We can talk about beads?
We're talking about beads.
Talking about the beads.
You know? And who is the number one journalist in all gaming? You know, we may talk about these things. You know, we may spend some things here and there, you know? We'll see. It'll be very interesting. Cracking jokes, man. Riku, hopefully you'll be back on for episode 400, you know?
Hey, man, if you can have me.
Yes.
I'll definitely try my best to slide through.
You know, Jeezy may roll up. No, that's not going to happen.
Fucking hilarious.
Oh, man. Hey, shout out to that brother. Do your thing, man. Do your thing. You know?
Him and Hard Jess.
Yeah, him and Hard Jess, for real. Man, OG Throwdown for life, you know? These motherfuckers don't know, man. anyway, make sure you follow Throwdown on Twitch and Twitter. Hit us up on Discord, where the rumors and Bob Hits, who was not here tonight, is always spreading the craziest rumors of it. I don't know where he gets these things from. I really don't. Throwdown's on every podcast app. Just search for Throwdown Show, towards Throwdown Show. You can also visit throwdownshow.com to listen to previous episodes. And if you have been watching us on YouTube and you enjoy the content, make sure you hit like, subscribe, and hit the bell to be notified of when new premieres go live. and links to everything down below. Once again, I'm your host, Tony Polanco, and tonight is run by Carlos Romero.
Hey, peace out.
Chris Seeley.
Hey, take care, everyone.
Brett Murdoch.
Peace out, everyone.
Brian Monjoma.
There, guys.
And Riku-san, one, the only one.
See you when I see you guys.
All right, we'll be back on Sunday. No, we're not taking off for the holidays. We'll be here on Sunday, man. So let's do this later.
And we're definitely not taking off July 3rd.
No, well, no, we're not. Because that is Sunday, motherfucker. Yeah. That's what I just said. All right, people, we'll see you, man, later.
Ladies. Peace.